you, Ron, and thank you all for coming today to discuss this important topic. Before I get started, I want to mention that I have included some questions throughout the talk. These are questions for you guys. Okay, we're going to take a little spin here and try to get a little participation. So I ask when you see a question slide that if someone has the answer or would like to answer, please raise your hand so we can do this in order, because there are prizes that you will get with the answers. So as Ron described, I'll be talking about the biology and life history of quagga mussels and zebra mussels. Before I get started, though, I want to take a minute just to describe the California Sea Grant Program. There tends to be a lot of confusion about who I'm with. Is it Sea Grant? Is it UCSB? And then why UC San Diego? Why does that pop up? So to give you a better idea of how the Sea Grant Program works, California Sea Grant is part of the National Sea Grant Program, which is part of NOAA. So every coastal state and coastal areas, including the Great Lakes, have a Sea Grant Program. There's 33 programs. All right, the California Sea Grant Program is actually administered and is a department at the Scripps Institute of Oceanography down at UC San Diego. So I'm an employee of UC San Diego. However, there is one of three components of the Sea Grant Programs, which is called the Sea Grant Extension Program. That's the part I work with. And there are eight of us in that program. We are called specialists. And we are housed at various UC and Cal State facilities. So hence my association with UC Santa Barbara. That's where I'm housed. And I had worked at UC Santa Barbara before, so it's been a nice little extension, but now am paid by Sea Grant. And some of you are more familiar with Sea Grant than others, but basically the Sea Grant specialists, we work with community members on identifying and trying to come up with solutions to various issues regarding coastal and marine resources. And we all have different specialties. I am the main one that works on aquatic invasive species for the state. So we do work throughout the state, even though we are housed at certain locations. And we address these issues by identifying not only research needs and then trying to conduct research, so we do get grants and have students and, you know, address those kind of needs, but also by doing outreach like these workshops and putting together materials, educational materials for people. So it's kind of a whole mishmash of things and a lot of groups involved. So biology, life history information. Why are we taking some time to discuss this? A lot of you already know some of this information. Well, us biology geeks, of course, think it's really interesting, so we have to share it with you. But in terms of management, it's really important to understand the biology and life history of the pest, right? In order to think about early detection and monitoring, you have to know what you're going to be targeting, where it lives, things like that. Also, in terms of eradication and control, all those life history characteristics, you're trying to look for vulnerable aspects of that pest, right? How can you target it? How can you control or eradicate it? So what you're looking for, stages to target, where to target it, what habitat to target it in, and when and how often do you need to monitor and or apply your control or eradication efforts. So it is important. It's also interesting, hopefully. And with that, you've actually seen this. Quaggas, yes. You can see why, or whoever named it, they were thinking about the beautiful zebra and the now extinct quagga. There is a lot of variation in the color and striping patterns of these two species, so it really isn't the best way to identify. As Ron described, there is some things with the shape and the way they will stand up or not when you put them on an edge. Basically, they're very similar. There are some variations in some of their requirements, their physiological requirements. Quaggas tend to be a little more, they tend to be stronger. And so we have the one that's a bigger problem right here locally. You saw this in the video, the basic invasion pattern that occurred. Where did they come from? Ukraine and Russia, long way away. They invaded the rest of Europe, as they described, through the canal systems that were built, and then they invaded the US through ballast water. You saw some of this as well. These maps are actually available on the USGS website. And as you can see, started in the late 80s, started spreading 5 years later throughout the Midwest, started heading south about 10 years later, got more concentrated and dense in those areas, and then it made it to the west, into Nevada and California first. Now it's also gotten into Colorado and Utah, as you've heard, and as the bottom map shows, both quaggas and zebra mussels are in California, but primarily quagga mussels in Southern California. The quagga mussels in California primarily arrived via the aqueduct, right? Not through boating. However, as we've learned, there's now two populations, the one here in Piru and then the zebra mussel population up at San Benito that appears to have come through via boats. It's an interesting little tidbit of information is through genetic analyses, they've determined that these quagga mussels are most related to some that were found in New York. So not the closest population. Lake Mead, yeah, those, yes. I don't think they've done any analyses on Piru, but the feeling is the majority of the California populations have come from Lake Mead, which has been associated with New York, okay? So what is a mussel? It's a mollusk. That includes snails and clams and things like that, right? Mollusks, basically, they pump water past their gills, they get food that way, and oxygen. Now you heard a little bit about their high filtration rates, and that's what causes a lot of the impacts. They're continually pumping water and feeding. Mollusks also have a mantle that surrounds the body. It's a little bit hard to see in that photograph, but you can see kind of a little area here and here. That's surrounding the body inside the shell. They also have a shell and a muscular foot, which a lot of people don't realize on mussels. There's a foot that will come out. Mussels are also known as bivalves. So within the mollusks, there's bivalves. Bivalves, pretty descriptive, two valves, right? So clams also have two valves, right? But what about snails and limpets, which are snail-like? Only a single shell, right? So they're not bivalves. We can cross them off. And then in terms of mussels versus clams and things like that, the shell shape tells you a lot. Basically, mussels are more ear-shaped. They have a wider section that goes down and becomes narrow, versus clams being much more symmetrical. Also, the mussels, the quagga and zebra mussels have a way to attach to substrates. And that's very similar to the marine mussels that you can see along the beach. They use viscal threads. And that's the foot will attach, come out, attach, and lay these threads that help it to attach to a substrate. Very important distinguishing point. So, first question. What are three biological characteristics that would indicate what you are looking at is not a quagga zebra mussel? Anyone wanna? Three. Usually people come up with two. Yes?
You look for the viscal threads. You look for either if they have one shell, or if they have their bivalves, mm-hmm. If they have the one shell. And also their shape and their color.
Excellent. Do you mind? Can we have a nice little water? Yeah, see? Good job. Yeah, so hopefully you all heard her. Basically, you look for attachment. Is it attached with threads? Snails can be attached with their foot, right? But they will slide or actually fall off if you actually hit them. Versus the shell shape, and then the presence of a shell. Is there a shell present? If not, definitely not a mussel. And is it a single shell or a double bivalve shell? Okay, the life cycle. So, Quagga and zebra mussels have separate sexes, males and females. The females will release the eggs into the water column. Sperm will be in the water column. They will fertilize there. They actually will stay and develop in the water column, which I'll get to in a minute. But one of the things that makes them so problematic is their high reproductive capacity. So they can actually release up to 1 million eggs per year. Depends on their size, depends on the conditions, depends how many times they spawn. But that's a lot for a single. You've seen pictures of all of those mussels covering things. They're continually reproducing in some situations, warmer water. Guess what? Piru tends to have some pretty warm water most of the year, right? So that's what makes quagga and zebra mussels very problematic. In terms of the larval phase, that's the first phase. So the first phase continues in the water column. They actually will live in the water column for various amounts of times. It depends on the amount of food, water temperatures, and basically it's believed it's about a 6-week period. Can be faster, can be slower, depending on food and water temperatures. But basically during that time, the mussel will go through 4 stages. They have 4 larval stages. Different things are developing. They will move throughout the water column and feed during that time. When they're moving around, a lot of, I guess traditionally, the thought was larvae just kind of got moved around by the currents. It's not the case. They actually can direct their movements, move up and down, around. So it's not quite as haphazard as we once thought. But the larvae are microscopic. You can't see them with your naked eye. You actually have to take a look at the water sample and look for them. One really cool thing about them is if you use polarized light on your microscope, you will get this, what they call the Maltese cross. And they showed a picture of that in the video. The shell actually refracts back this little cross, which helps with identification. All right, so they're in the water column. It's time to attach. They'll go through a metamorphosis where they will attach to a substrate. I've heard a little bit of talk about that. At first, they may attach to filamentous substrates. They actually will attach to algae and ropes. Anyone who's dealt with quagga or zebra mussels, you often find them on the rope that you have for your sampling substrates. They do tend to move off of those types of substrates onto hard surfaces, though, for the majority of their life. That's what they most prefer. They can, however, attach or settle out on sand. That doesn't tend to happen until you have a very high population density, though. Okay, so it's not the preferred habitat. Important to keep in mind, especially when it's an early infestation, there are some hot spots that you can really target and look for. They settle out at a pretty small size, but one that you can actually see or feel, 1 to 3 millimeters. And they mature really quickly, yet another problem with these guys. They will mature at a very small size, 7 to 10 millimeters, so basically 1/4 inch to 3/8 of an inch, very small. And overall, we consider them relatively small. They don't get very, very large compared to, say, the marine mussels that you'll see out on the beach. 2 inches tends to be pretty typical for max sizes. We heard on the video, it's larger, and again, zebra and quagga mussels somewhat vary, and again, the conditions that they're growing in will cause differences in shell size. And the lifespan is about 3 to 5 years, thought to be. All right, ready for another prize? Where in a lake would you look for or monitor each of the 3 life history phases of quagga and zebra mussels? So there's 3 phases, right? Larvae, juvenile, adults. Where would you monitor or look for them?
Hard surfaces.
Which phase?
Would that be adult or semi-adult? Where the dissolved oxygen is high enough to maintain life, first of all. Where there is enough zooplankton for them to filter. That's all I can think of.
Okay, So basically, for the larvae, they're going to be in the water column, right? And he had some great points on where within the water column you want to look for them. They do need oxygen and food to survive. Juveniles and adults, hard surfaces. But again, don't forget about algae, especially for the smaller ones. If you are a lake manager and you have a marina and there's algae growing, you, when you pull it out, you might check it. You should look for it. Also, things like buoy lines or your wake speed lines, the lines that go to that, are also good places to look. And of course, under docks and hard surfaces like that, any kind of platform that they can attach to. So, forgot about the prize here. How about a Sea Grant bag?
There you go.
It's nice and small and it expands for all your groceries. Okay. So, habitat requirements. Most of you are aware of a lot of the risk analyses that have been done to determine whether or not lakes may or may not support quagga and zebra mussel infestations. There are a lot of different variables. These are not hard set numbers. They all interact together, so it's important to remember that. You heard in the video, some places the calcium levels might not be quite optimal or quite right, but there's a lot of food, or the temperatures are just right, so they're not stressed and they can handle differences in some of the other factors. This chart is one of many that you can come across. It's actually in a monitoring manual that I have some copies of, that if anyone would like one. We have some limited copies, it's also available on our website. But basically, without going through all this, there's a lot of things to consider. Just like us, there's a lot of things that can stress them out or keep them happy. Piru tends to have a lot of things that keep them happy, which is unfortunate, but why they're doing so well. All right, in terms of growth rates can vary quite a bit, even amongst individuals that are from the same group. So in other words, the siblings. They tend to slow down as the mussels get larger. Does anyone know why? Actually, this isn't a gift question. Sorry. But anyway, growth tends to slow down with a lot of things as they grow. And there's one big reason. They become mature. So they're putting a lot of energy into maturation and reproducing instead of growth. So with Lake Mead, what they've seen is this reduction in growth rates. They're actually seeing it at fairly small sizes. And part of that's why they're maturing at a very small size, right? Usually 7 to 10 millimeters, somewhere in there. Their growth rates, they've estimated maximum growth rates of 2.4 millimeters per month. Keep that number in your mind for a moment. So in about 4 months, they're reaching 10 millimeters. They're basically becoming reproductive within 4 months. And they've predicted that their annual growth rates are about 18 millimeters. So how does that compare to Piru? Now there's a lot going on in this slide. I'm not gonna go through it all, but let me walk you through a couple quick points here. You'll see all these graphs. These are basically showing you the size distributions of mussels that have settled out since March. So on the x-axis, you have the shell length. On the y, you have the percent of mussels within a subsample that are at each of those sizes. And the main thing to notice is the scale for the x-axis. It goes from 8 to 10 to 14. Things are growing. And what we can do with these is look for the outcrops, the different cohorts. So for instance, in the very first one, March, those are all from the same group. They all settled out in March. They had roughly 30 days to grow, and this is what we saw in growth rates. Average size was 3.8 millimeters, so they're growing on average about 4 millimeters a month. There are some that are growing faster and some that are growing slower, but on average about 4 millimeters a month. If you are to follow that group through the next month, you see that growth is somewhat the same, of almost 3.5 millimeters a month. And then as we go on one more month, we see a little bit of a drop, and that's based on, but that's basically kind of what we expected, right? As they get bigger and they're approaching reproductive size, the growth rates are going to slow down. So comparative to Lake Mead, they are growing faster. And if you just look at it this way, the same group of animals going through time, we can see they're reaching 10 millimeters in 3 months. And some are actually reaching it quicker than that. Now we know throughout the season, growth rates can increase and decrease. We'll see as time goes on what happens throughout the summer and fall months. In terms of settlement.
And why do you think that is?
The changes in growth rates?
More quickly in Pyrwood than in Mead.
There's a couple different factors. Number one, we don't have a whole year of data and they've averaged it over the year. Mead tends to get colder, has periods where they're not growing so fast and not as much food produced throughout the year as Piru, and that's just periphery, you know, without having studies and numbers to compare. But again, water temperature and food availability are very important factors that affect growth. So in terms of settlement, the mussels, when we first started this, you know, we thought we had a little bit of time, and the reason we thought that was based on some information from San Diego reservoirs. What we found there early on in 2008 at Lake Miramar was there's really just one major peak when the mussels would settle out from the water column onto substrates. And that was in June and July. A little bit going on in the fall, but mainly there was 2 months. And then there was a whole bunch of time, November to May, where we weren't seeing anything happening. That was a low infestation. A couple of years later, we did a similar study comparing amongst several reservoirs. One that had a very low infestation basically was showing somewhat of a similar pattern. Didn't have huge peaks, but basically summer months were most important, and a big period of time where nothing was happening. They weren't reproducing, nothing was settling out. Well, it turned out Lake Miramar started to get a little bit of a higher infestation, but we looked at that. And basically, again, we were kind of finding the same thing. Summer's critical, fall still going on. And for the most part, the same number of months, there was no activity or no much, you know, not much reproduction or settlement going on. This wasn't the case at Otay, which has a very high infestation. There, we actually were finding, again, summer, a lot going on, but actually through the fall even, down there. These are all San Diego reservoirs. So the period where there was little to no settlement became very small. Basically 3 months? No, 2 months, sorry. with these high infestation rates. And again, down in these areas, the water tends to be warmer and conditions are conducive for quagga and zebra mussels, right? So how does this compare to Piru? Well, we don't have a whole lot of data yet, but with everybody's help at Piru, we've been able to get a little bit of data coming in. And basically, we did see there wasn't much activity early on. So December, January, not seeing much. February, though, we got a little hit, and that really increased in March. So here we see it started early compared to what we expected. Now, we all know that the last 2 years, weather's been very different. Pretty warm compared to most of the years that these other studies were done. So it's not so much that we have this new stronger quagga mussel, it's just the environmental conditions are more conducive. What's gonna happen? We don't know, and we'll, you know, keep tracking it. But basically this is looking more like a high infestation level or high infestation of quagga mussels at this point. Which is, of course, bad news because it means they're continually reproducing and things are settling out. So, how is this information on settlement and growth rates useful for managing quagga and zebra mussels? Why are we telling you this? Except for, again, the biology, wow, this is cool. It is useful. Do you have an answer? Question?
I don't know if it's the correct answer, but maybe if you know what months that they're lower and not reproducing, maybe that's the time you guys can start managing it or seeing if you can get the levels down for them not to reproduce for the next time. I'm not quite sure, but
yeah, no,
maybe
no.
Something like that, so you know what months to try to manage it better.
It's
or
actually,
maybe stop them.
Yes.
Oh,
we have a travel mug for you.
Travel mug.
But I'm going to say it a little bit differently. Basically, with this information, we can figure out how often and when to monitor or apply eradication control tactics, right? Because you can see, like she said, you know, are things present? Are they settling? What are we going to target? How long do we need to do it for? So it is important to know and think about it. All right, in terms of management, again, what we're really looking to do is reduce the spread to other reservoirs, as well as reduce impacts within the place where it's lives. And so one way to do this is to apply an integrated pest management approach. Most of you have heard of that before. It's basically an approach used traditionally for managing agricultural pests. Very seldom has it been applied or talked about in terms of aquatic invasive species. But it does provide this very nice framework for coming up and thinking through the process of managing a pest. And three of the basic components are to target multiple stages using multiple techniques so that you can hit it from all sides in different ways. And using these different techniques that minimize impacts to economic human health and the environment. So on the left you see this pyramid. These are the tactics that are considered. They basically fall into four categories: cultural, mechanical or physical, biological, and chemical. And the concept is you want to use the ones at the top the least often, using the more benign tactics below. But again, it's the combination and thinking through the characteristics of the pest and which of these tactics actually can you use to target the pest in those particular life history stages. So in terms of the larval phase, when you think about it, think about, okay, it's in the water column, right? Really important to remember that. How are you going to target it? You got to go where it lives, in the water column. And it's only during certain times of the year, though, right? When they're spawning. So knowing the spawning timing, again, as we just discussed, is really important. So knowing these things, what kind of management tactics do you think it could use? Anybody want to throw out? All right, well, we heard about basically draining the lake, or a lot of what is happening in other lakes are water drawdown. Some of it's natural due to the drought, but you can see on the right hand the picture here. This is after a water drought drawdown at El Capitan. A lot of things get exposed, the mussels are gonna die, reducing the population and the amount of reproduction going on within the lake. You can treat the water, chemicals, biocides, or you can try to filter the water. There's two ways: artificial filtering, which obviously large amounts of water, very difficult to do, or biological type filtration. And it's always important to consider combining these techniques. So again, we heard an example earlier, someone was talking about, you know, drawing down the lake or draining it as far as you can or to a certain point. Well, then you might want to add treatment of chemicals if you can, or do some other types of biological or other types of control.
Is treating the water with chemicals and biocides really viable in a body of water like pyrite? I mean, wouldn't there possibly be some residual?
It's possible, but it.
Biocides left there even after you did it?
Anything's possible, right? Just keep it on the positive side. But, you know, there has been successful eradications in quarries. You know, Piru's fairly small. That's the good news. There is some good news. and so from that perspective, you know, it's possible. There's clearly other complications with considering some of these other alternatives, including chemicals for Piru, though. So it's needing to continue the water flow downstream. That's a big one, right? That's what we've heard a lot about today.
What about the fact that some communities downstream, some of the unincorporated neighborhoods depend on that water for drinking water? Is that a problem?
In terms of chemicals?
Yeah.
Yes, and that's what led to this study regarding some biological control work. So working in San Diego, all those reservoirs are drinking water reservoirs. And so chemicals were not an option at all. And so there was discussions about what are some of the other options. And so fish biocontrol, if you've looked at the literature or heard people talk, there's been a lot of interest mainly in red ear sunfish as shell crunchers. They can eat the mussels. But we also wanted to look at, are there any planktivores, you know, things that can filter the water, take out all those veligers, so they can't settle and cause some of these problems.
What about ag? Because some of the water from Pyro is used for farming. Is biological treatment viable?
In terms of the water
sent downstream for irrigation for crops that people eat?
Yes. So in this case, with the fish, these are resident fish that basically are already present. The idea is to move them, cage them into areas where you can really reduce the amount of larvae. So you look for those hot spots where they're going to settle. You know, larvae are going to be moving around and identifying those hot spots. So it doesn't necessarily take, you know, you're not trying to fill the whole lake with enough fish to control it. This is a very controlled and thought out process of targeting hot spots to greatly reduce the amount of larvae that's being produced.
Now, I was asking you about chemicals and biocides.
Oh.
Are they viable for a body of water that not only provides drinking water to humans, but also provides water for irrigation for food crops?
I think it depends on which ones you're talking about. So we know that some are more sensitive, some break down faster. Sometimes you can apply these things, again, by isolating areas, so using a method called tarping, where you can curtain off some areas and apply things to the point where the chemicals will break down before you remove any tarping. So they did that with chlorpa down in Carlsbad, which was a seaweed that got into a lagoon down there. So there's a lot of things to consider, and all these uses are important to also know. What, you know, and we'll play into what can be used or not used. So just real quickly, there was some interest down in San Diego to look at the use of resident fishes. And again, when I use the word resident and not native, because a lot of reservoirs have been stocked and have always supported non-native species such as bluegill. And what we found was when we did we allowed fish to be present, we basically had very little settlement, which you see on the right-hand side. When the fish were not present, there was a lot more settlement going on. About 70% of these substrates were getting covered by mussels. And you look at the substrates and you think, oh, those are really small. You know, that's great, but how applicable is that really? And what we actually were more excited about were these big nets that we had were all clean too, where the fish were, compared to ones that did not have fish. So it wasn't that they were just hanging around the few substrates that we had throughout this net, but they were moving around enough and feeding enough that it was keeping that population of mussels down within that whole area. Experimental level, we're just, you know, these are results that are just coming out, but potentially useful in certain circumstances. And there has been some talk about with agricultural canals, that the irrigation canals, that you might be able to do something like this. Okay, how about juvenile and adult phases of these mussels? So we know they're attached to substrates, right? And we know they settle at certain times of the year. So you can try and figure out when you might want to do some removals, right? Oops, I just spilled it. So management tactics. What kind of things could you do? I just told you one. All right, remove substrates. Can't always do that though, right? Can't remove a water tower. Be very hard to do. But in some cases, you can remove some of these substrates. So like docks. Some places, they actually pull out the docks just to maintain them, fix them, do whatever. This is something you might want to consider with quagga mussels. You know, you'd have to do it fairly frequently though, right? In a situation like Piru, where they're continually spawning and settling. So one thing that's been done with other systems is to rotate things in and out. So floating restrooms, another one that's got a lot of surface area for mussels to settle. Rotate those out, you know, pull them out before the mussels start reproducing. Obviously a little bit of labor involved. And you need twice as many of these structures to be able to rotate, right? But it still could help at least reduce the numbers. You could clean the substrates. Instead of removing them all the time, you could clean them. So you could do this by hand using suction pumps or through biocontrol. So again, I mentioned the red ear sunfish actually eat mussels. So the idea is if you could cage fish around your docks, maybe you could get them to eat the mussels. Now, one thing we found in our experiments was red ear really do like to eat in a certain position, orientation, tends to be downward, right? They're not going up like this. So docks may not be the best area for them. But any of the, if you had rocky areas, you could maybe cage them around there. Some ideas. The other thing below the fish picture there, does anyone know what that is? I heard someone say it.
Say it louder.
Oh, did you? You already know. Sponge. This is a freshwater sponge that occurred in various places, but it was found on the pump house out at Piru. And the really interesting thing was this, was the divers were removing it, and I started looking at it, and I'm like, this is growing right over the mussels. It's killing them. Do not remove it. Let it continue to grow. Now, unfortunately, or fortunately, sponges like a lot of water flow. So typically, the mussels are not found in those areas. So it's not anything to get too excited about. But it was an interesting little thing to keep in mind in terms of using Mother Nature to your advantage at times. How about reducing the oxygen around the substrates? So this is that tarping that I was talking about. It also is referred to as benthic mats, used a lot in weed control. We call it tarping because you could also put these mats around something. It doesn't always have to be on the bottom. But the basic idea is you are going to contain an area that has a high population, cut off all the oxygen, and let it go to kill off those mussels. Water drawdowns, again, they're exposed to air, right? They don't have water anymore, so eventually they will die and draining the lake. And again, we talked about the chemical and biocides. So you have a suite of things to think about. Again, really important to consider combining them. Not all these things work in all the different areas. So depending on the conditions, the environment, the topography, you may have to use different things in different places within a lake.
How effective is tarping at depth?
It appears to be pretty effective, actually. They've been using it to control Asian clam up at Lake Tahoe. In the 90s, I think I saw 98% as one of their last analyses. Is that right? Yeah, that's what you saw too.
Yeah.
So, and I don't remember what water depth they're at, but they're fairly deep. I will mention in a minute, though, some other issues about that. But we have one more question, one more prize. What are two components of an IPM approach that may increase the success of management efforts for quagga and zebra mussels? So think again about the framework and the approach. Ah, yes?
Clean the substrates, reduce the oxygen around the clean the substrates, reduce the oxygen around the substrates, treat the substrates.
Those are great tactics. And so the idea is to combine them and also try to target multiple stages, right? That's one of the advantages. The other thing, which I think I forgot to mention, was this IPM, the approach is very adaptive. And so you're continually taking records and seeing how it's working and changing things and adapting it. Very important part of the whole concept. So thank you. There's a hat for you. All right, so with all that in mind, just quickly some of the recommendations that have been made for Lake Piru. The manual mechanical removal, you know, it's very benign. You can get out there and do it. It's a lot of labor, a lot of expense, but it can be done up to a certain point. So initially with small infestations, this is a way that could be done very quickly as long as you get divers in the water. So anyone who's at a lake that doesn't have mussels, making sure you have divers that can do this kind of work, and having all the legal permissions and things to get divers in the water is really important to line up ahead of time so you can do it quickly. You can't do this in all places, however. These mussels are small. They like to get in little crevices. If you have little slate rocks that go like this, it's hard to get in there to get them. So one of the other things for Piru that was discussed was the use of this tarping method. Now, as I just described, it's being used for Asian clam up at Tahoe, and it was successfully used to eradicate Calerpa down in Carlsbad. Those habitats are very different than Piru. They don't have rock, and they don't slope so much. Two things that can make this very difficult to seal the tarps off. So we were able to do some pilot studies to make sure this was actually something that looked useful, and that did prove to be highly effective with some modifications, of course. But the idea was, you know, given the types of habitats, can you really seal it off to have a reduction in the mussels and kill them off? And the other one was the biological control. So again, if there's bluegills and there's red ears present, can we actually cage them in areas to greatly reduce the amount of reproduction and settlement that's going on? And that comes down to making sure you have the right fish and the right sizes, right, and the numbers that you need. So with that, thanks again for being here, and I'm looking forward to working with you to help hopefully minimize the spread and impacts of quagga mussels. Thanks.
You did try to fish at Piru, right?
We tried to get fish, and we had some problems, so it really hasn't been tested, and we're still in discussions, but you know, the bluegill, we worked with Fish and Game, I forgot to mention that, although it was up on the slide, partnered, and they've been really helpful in doing some of the surveys and collections of fish at some of our other sites. But the bluegill were basically non-existent at the time we did the surveys and locations we did surveys. Not to say we can't get them. Again, they have the right gear and setups to do the work, so it's something to still be looked at. So, we'll see.
And I think it would also require permissions to transfer from one location to the other. You can't just simply go out and capture fish in one area and bring them to Lake Tucker.
Right. So the idea here is not to introduce any fish from anywhere else. So we're just trying to capture them in Lake Piru and then put them into cages in Lake Piru. So no bringing more fish in, different fish in, things like that.
And so with the pilot programs that you have done there, it sounds like the populations are still increasing. Is that what you found?
With the mussels?
At Piru, yeah.
Yes. Yes. You'll hear later, I didn't want to go into what's actually happening, but the recommendations, you'll hear more about what's actually being done to try to reduce the numbers at a little later today.
Hi, we are monitoring our reservoirs in Slo County, and with one of them, we are putting, but we're putting in substrates to see if there are quaggas or zebras that appear. We clean them every 4 weeks. Is that not enough time? Should we not clean them? Is that enough time to actually, we're feeling around, but we're just wondering if we should wait longer.
Or maybe just clean like a quarter of them, or do we scrub it all off?
Yeah.
I've been cleaning.
Everyone has their own theory about this, so that's why I'm smirking a little bit. But no, 4 weeks should be more than enough time. And When you clean them, some people worry that you might knock off ones that if you let it go another month, you would then see. That's a valid concern. But you also may get more growth and have other issues with the plates where you're not able to detect as well. So I recommend the monthly cleaning. And when we say cleaning, it's just wiping them off, right? You're not like decontaminating them or doing anything.
Just take a scraper.
Yeah.
Scrape just to make sure it's not stuck on there because dirt or algae
right.
Get stuck on the substrates or the plastic little pieces we put down.
Sounds perfect.
So we just scrub it. Yeah, we're fairly new to this.
Yeah.
She's been doing it for a little bit, but they had a great system already in play. We're just taking it over.
I'm pretty new to the mussels, and I'm curious. I've seen the video, a different video or similar, about them lasting for a while in just wet conditions. So I was just wondering how long they last in wet conditions.
So if they stay moist and cool, it's the projections I've seen or have heard is 30 days. And that's what a lot of the boat, you'll hear about some of the boat stuff, 30 days is the magic number. So it's quite a while. But keep in mind if it's really hot and not so moist, they'll die a lot faster than that. One thing about the monitoring, really important to check the line.
Yeah, the rope.
So the whole thing. The thing with substrates is, you're trying to target, and I didn't go into this, but we can talk about it if you like, is, where are they going to settle out? So we have done experiments looking at different water depths to identify, some of the key depths you might want to put your substrates, and it varies like the lake, of course, because of things like food availability. That's a little problematic, but if you have a line that's extended throughout the water column, that line, they will settle on that line. So making sure you check that line is a great way to increase potential detection.
Yeah, we make sure that our substrates, we can't see up to the non-vis to the eye as we look down, just so because they would probably grow in a darker area. So we do have a pretty long line. Because some of our reservoirs are actually pretty nice, the visibility's high.
Okay, yeah. So, and we can talk some more about it if you want. But yeah, it sounds like you're doing very nice. Yes.
How long do you think quaggas would last if the
How long do you think quaggas would last if the lake were drained? In other words, I've heard some United officials today say, they'd live in the mud. But they don't really live in, the mud would not dry out overnight if the lake bottom were exposed. And it might be wet for 3-4 feet down or more at the bottom, but it will dry out eventually. But my assumption is that isn't the way they don't, once they're exposed to oxygen and heat from the sun and no water except the muddy water they're sitting on top of,
yes,
they would die, correct?
So 30 days, you would think, that should be the max.
I mean, if they live on a boat hull for 30 to 35 days, I would think they're not going to live much longer than that, even with some moisture in the muddy bottom of the lake as it dries out.
So as long as there's no replenishment of water, the conditions in some of those lower layers, it should go anoxic. There should be not be much oxygen. They can close up, however, so you've got to go past that point to this 30-day thing. But it's hard to know. And it's something you'd want to monitor. So with our tarps, we were monitoring and trying to see how long it was taking. We had, oxygen meters and also actually had some sentinel mussels that we caged and we could pull out to see what was happening. So things like that would have to be, that would be the best way to do it.
Has that strategy been employed before? Draining a body of water to kill them?
They did it in Kansas.
Successfully?
Silver bullet. at this point, but there are things to consider. And again, using some combination tactics is probably a good way to do it. So I just want to quickly mention, I forgot to do this, but if anyone's interested in the Sea Grant program and who might be closest to you, there will be a sheet out after the break. Also, I mentioned the monitoring manual. I do have some hard copies, and you can also get it online. And I think Ron's going to bring this up later, but we did have a quagga and zebra mussel eradication and control workshop a few years ago, and this is a technical report that kind of goes through the tactics and the concept of IPM. I have limited copies in the back. It is also available online. You can print out each chapter by itself or however. So those will be available later. Thank you.
Okay, great.